So, but now we start with the first presentation, publication of Inspire Datasets as Linked Data by Enrique.
Okay, hello everyone. As Torsten have commented, the presentation is about solving or trying to provide alternatives for the use and the publication of the Inspire datasets, and use them as linked data so they can be better exploited by third parties. I will start with a revision on the motivation of this work that we have done for the Spanish National Mapping Agency. Then the technologies and the status of the different standards, following by a workflow that we have created as a proposal for the conversion and the publication of the Inspire data to linked data using RDF, and finally show you some use cases and conclusions of the work. Well, starting with the motivation of all this project, the thing is how to make the information from Inspire that the member states already have available for the most possible amount of people, for the people in general. As you know, there are open data initiatives, and there are many initiatives that to use and reuse and add value to the public data. One in this line, we have Inspire as a motivation, as a European directive for all the member states countries to try to make the information available in each country public. And the goal with Inspire is that has tried or is harmonizing all the data models and the way that the information and the services, the information is presented, the data model itself and also the services. It has been thought to an European scale, but the truth is that for each member state has been also a challenge, and has also make a very positive impact in how the information is distributed and reused inside the country, each country. And this directive, Inspire make the information public via all the standards of the OGC, you know, WMS, CSW, all the download services, SOS, WFS, all of them. But this information is available to a certain amount of people. It's public, of course, but only the geo people know how to explode it, how to use it, how to discover it, how to download it, how to deal with it. So what we have tried here is to make a kind of proof of concept on how to use other technologies on top of Inspire. I mean, we have the information on Inspire, and we make an adaptation of that information, so that information can be reused and spread to get to more people. Okay, so these other technologies is when the semantic web appears. So the thing is that we have chosen linked data and RDF as a way of using the semantic web, and to translate the Inspire data published to this RDF, so we can make the information public, not in this different language, not only for the people with an SPARQL endpoint and so on, but also findable by the search engines. By now, with the CSWs and the WFS, okay, you can download a full data set of addresses or hydrography or whatever, but you cannot type in Google, give me the Danube River or how to find this address, which is already published in Inspire, but Google is not indexing, it's not Google or any search engine is not indexing that information. So that information is official, is there, is public, but the normal people, not the geospatial world, not the phosphor G people, Normal people do not know how to find it or how to use it. So we have thought that a possible approach to it is to make a kind of proxy to publish it as RDF, so it could be eventually indexed by any search engine. And also offers the possibility, as the semantic web is something that is very old in the non-spatial world, so it can be combined with any other sources that speak the same RDF language, okay? So we can make it linkable, this official data, to other sources. As commented, the goal of this linked data is that it is also a long-standing technology supported by several standards, and also has the people from Arena, the Arena activity, has also realized that it can be a possibility to explore this linked data option to publish the inspired information. So there has been also an activity in this case to support this kind of publication. So with the publication of the inspired information in the linked data format, we can integrate different data sources and reuse the official geospatial information with external ones like DBPedia or GeoNames. But the first goal here is to define a methodology that could help us to make it consistent in different inspired themes or even in different use cases or for a different country. So we have been also defining this methodology as a kind of workflow, and also choosing the technology framework for this workflow implementation. The state of art of the semantic web is, well, we have the RDF or the OWL from the W3C that standardized the way that semantic web and linked data is structured. And you have to, it's an abstract concept, but I think that the best way to understand the RDF is that it's just another data model that you have defined several hierarchies, and at some points you link at a certain level of that hierarchy or that data model, and then you can start to relate different data sources. Then to explode this semantic web and linked data, there exists the GeoSPARQL standard supported and developed by the OGC that produce RDF queries, spatial queries, and predicates to perform the more usual operations in the intersections and so on, playing with the geometry and with RDF. So you could mix things, for example, or give me the natural areas intersecting with this river and that kind of queries, mixing different data sources in RDF via the GeoSPARQL endpoint. So we have had a defined, we think, a simple workflow to migrate the information from what we have here in the step zero will be the features published according to Inspire in WFS, in a WFS service. Okay, from that, the first step will be making a mapping to the ontologies that we will explain later, then an ETL to generate the RDF, then upload the RDF to the SPARQL endpoint, and then start playing with the SPARQL endpoint, not only on this, also building applications on top of it. For the extraction of the inspired datasets, we have selected a few of them, which we have been researching and thinking which will be the ones that could mix with that value to external economic operators, for whoever who want to make routings or who want to make environmental or environmental processes and so on. We have picked up the administrative units, municipalities and so on, geographical names, transport network for optimal paths, the hydrography for the environmental, and the addresses in case you want to reach places. I think those are the usual. So from this WFS services inspired compliant that we have picked up, the first step, the second step, sorry, has been to map the schema to the ontology. Here, there is an activity from the ARENA project where they have defined the spatial a series of good practices and also vocabularies for the inspired themes in RDF. So you can find the data model in WFS and also the RDF in ARENA, the RDF corresponding to that inspired data model. So what you have to do then is to make the mapping, which is quite straight. Of course, always there are small differences that you can struggle and tackle them when you are doing the mapping, but in principle it's a kind of one-to-one thing. Then what we have to do is to pick up the GML, and with those mapping that we have defined in step number two, create the RDF triples, which is practically what we have said before with the WMS GML, and then the ontologies from the ARENA one-to-one. Here we have given a thought to all of this, and finally we came to an ad hoc ETL script in Python. We tried to use kind of GeoKettle and also RML to define the mapping from the XML to the RDF format, but with so large amount of data in the GMLs, they are huge, finally crashed it. So we couldn't make it work. With enough reliability with existing tools because of the huge UML that was produced by the WFS. So finally we had to run batches with Python. It was quite straightforward, and it was translated from the GML to the RDF. Then when we have the RDF, the thing is to upload to an endpoint. Here with the endpoint we have two, let's say, main in our research, from our experience. We have located the two main RDF servers for the linked data, which are Virtuoso and also Parliament. Parliament is a database with an endpoint for the triples, and Virtuoso is a little bit more. But we have, in a previous experience, we chose Virtuoso, and it worked with points. But for complex operation, we were not able to make it work. So we tested Parliament with more complex features like lines and polygons instead of points, and it has worked. So we finally chose Parliament as the endpoint for the RDF and the SPARQL. And then once you have generated the RDF files, it's quite easy to upload them and then have the endpoint to test the RDF and make the queries in SPARQL. Mm-hmm. So finally, once you have uploaded it, you automatically have an endpoint. You have here the URL, and you have a window there where you can write the SPARQL query and start to mix the sources with another RDF sources. Now, with this, it will be achieved one of the main issues that we wanted to address with this project, which is to be able to publish the inspired information in linked data format, so it could be exploded in a machine-to-machine process. But we also wanted to integrate it with external sources as DBPedia or GeoNames. So here, what we have to do is in the SPARQL property, sorry, query, define a property where we say that these two tags are equivalent. If you remember from the previous slides, we said that we could think on this linked data thing as data models. They are all different, but at some points you can link them with a tag like same as. You can say, I don't know, the name of a municipality, it can be NUTS3 name, and in the other city name. You say, define this is the same, and then you can link all the ontology. So with the add of this tag to the query, you have the query on linking external sources. So you obtain a second goal, which is connecting Spire's data sets to another external source. And now here it's a little bit of samples of several of the steps that we have commented before. Here you have the conversion from GML to RDF. As commented, it can be done with any ETL, but because of the size, we made it with Python scripts. Here is a query, and SPARQL query that mixes the information from the Inspire RDF and the DBPedia endpoint by setting up filters and mixing the both sources of data. This is the endpoint of Parliament. But this is the result, okay, where we have the WKT of the geometry, where has it been obtained from. And then on top of it, as another proof of concept, we made a map viewer that could explode and physically shows in a map the results of those queries, just to make it more user friendly, because think that this SPARQL thing is not really designed for a person to do it. You can see this. This is SQL, but even more complex. So this is conceived for machine-to-machine queries. So with these SPARQL queries, we have achieved a good performance with the Parliament. We have been able to link the DBPedia and GeoNames to the RDF, linking the Inspire themes that we have published. And here we have another example. You can see here the same as tag linking the both origins. And finally, what you obtain here is information that little pop-up with the name and the population that seems very little thing is mixing two different data origins in linked data, okay? So as conclusions for these, as the results that we have obtained for this work, has been a pipeline or workflow to define the WFS to RDF translation and publication, and tools or scripts or a stack of technologies to be able to do it so with those inspired themes. And for the Spanish National Agency, they have now an endpoint with all these inspired themes translated to RDF, so eventually a machine, a search engine, could index it. And well, this is it. This is a use case on how to translate from Inspire to RDF and connect it to external sources of data. So, if you have any questions.
Okay, thank you. Are there any questions?
Thanks a lot. I would have three fast questions. First one, this transformation script, is it accessible to for reuse? The second question is whether you are aware about some already indicated demand for the data you made available via linked data approach. And the third question goes for this linking of Inspire linked data with additional data resources. This linkage is executed during the generation of the query, or there is some specific environment where these links are created? Thanks.
Thank you. For the first one, still is on development. It's not in production. For the, they are testing, you have the endpoint here, but the scripts are still not available. But the Spanish National Mapping Agency is committed with the open source, so they will be available. What I can tell you here is to obtain that to know when it is available. The third question, it is made on the fly when you make that query, which also can lead to performance issues eventually, which is a weakness of this kind of approaches. But there are also, well, there are kind of catches, but we have not used them in this project. And the second, I'm sorry, but I was not able to pick it.
If you already receive some demand for the data from outside, someone, public sector, academia, NGOs?
Yeah, well, most universities are researching on this. We know that universities are digging into it as a possible way to make data more available and link information from different sources. Also, there are some public entities that have complementary data that have been interested in this approach, but well, they are studying this because in the end it's a matter of resources. Maybe for them it's easier to ask for the database and do it at home and not build an SPARQL endpoint and so on. It is more focused, I think, in the publishing the data for the web search engines. I think that's the goal there.
Do we have more questions? I think we still have time for a short one. No. Okay, if not, then thank you once again.